Romans chapter 8 and verses 14 through 16. Stand with me if you can in honoring of God's word. Number 14, it says, "For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God." The title of this message is "Cry, Your Dad Can Hear You." Let's pray. Your Father, my God, what an honor it is to be your son, and that you hear my pathetic little voice, God, and you care about me. You care about your children. What an amazing God you are that has created all the heavens and the earth, and yet you care about a little nothing like me. Oh God, may we just come near thee today. May your Holy Spirit just minister unto us, that we can feel your love and your mercy that you've shown to us. I pray, God, that today, that if someone here does not truly know you as their dad, as their father, as Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day, Lord. Today is the day of salvation, God. Thank you for your word, and thank you for your people, and thank you for establishing your church. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. Now, to adopt a child in America, it's not an easy task, is it? You know anything about that? Have you looked into it? It's not an easy task. It sometimes takes years upon years. It takes thousands of dollars. $5,000, $10,000 to adopt a child. You got to do home inspections. You got to do background checks. You got to do paperwork upon paperwork. And the reasoning is for this is for the protection of the child. The parent has to meet all these requirements to adopt this child. But there is a very different adoption process that has taken place. And the child is the one that has to meet this high standard, because the father that wants to adopt them is holy. He is pure. He cannot accept anybody that is sinful into his kingdom, into his family. And there's a huge problem with this. Huge. The children that he wants to adopt cannot meet this standard. They cannot meet perfection. For the Bible says, "There is none righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." His future children already have a wicked parent, the god of this world, or their own bellies. They don't want a heavenly father. They don't want anything to do with this God. They love their sin, the lust of their eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. They don't want another father. They're happy where they're at. And they're even considered enemies of God. Did you know that? Enemies. Romans chapter 3, verses number 11 through 18 gives a great description of a lost man, the lost people of this world, as you still are or once were. That's the only two places you can be. You used to be an enemy of God, or you still are an enemy of God. You got to have the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, this gives a good description. Romans chapter 3 in verse number 11. "There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They have all gone out of the way. They've altogether become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues they use deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and they in the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes." They're hopeless. Enemies of God. Enemies of the laws of God. Enemies of his holiness and his righteousness. But these children of disobedience are predestinated. Not all of them, but some of them are predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 5. We're going to do a lot of sword drills today. We're going to use this Holy Bible.
many scriptures, I believe. And I will not apologize. Make sure you lick your fingers. Don't get a paper cut. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 5. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to his good pleasure of his will. That's right. The only way you could be adopted to be a child of God if he has predestinated you. Because the only way that you can meet this perfect requirement to enter into the kingdom of heaven is if the first one born among the brethren meets it for you. That is the only way. The Lord Jesus Christ, he had to meet this requirement for you. That is the only way the ungodly can be adopted as children of God. That we can cry out to God. Cry out, Abba, Father, and he will hear you. So point number one is adopted by the blood. Now listen to this. Adoption is not a work of grace in us, but it's an act of grace without us. It's all of God and none of man. There's nothing like cute or good that I could do that God would look down upon Andrew and say, man, I'm gonna save that one. Nothing. It's a work outwardly. It's all about him. He chooses. The only way you can be adopted is if you believe. Believe what? Believe the gospel. The death, the burial, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Repenting of your sins. Having godly sorrow. And you must be born again. It's the only way you can be adopted. You must be. How much did you have to do with your physical birth? Your body? Nothing. You came out of your mother. That was it. You had no choice. When God saves you, it's his spirit. It's his spirit that adopts you into the family of God. It is only by him. This heavenly adoption process was not an easy one. It was not easy, just like the adoption process here, humanistically speaking, as we know. It was not easy. It's amazing. It's all of God and none of man. Zero. Men messed everything up. The eternal God, he does the unthinkable. He shows his mercy and his love and his kindness by dying for the ungodly. Listen to this, Romans chapter 5. I use this scripture all the time. It's a wonderful scripture. Romans chapter 5, starting in verse number 6. It says, for when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him. He showed, he commended, he gave his love towards us when you had nothing. All you had was your sin. And guess what? You loved it. And he still came. He still went to the cross. That's an amazing God we serve. Why did God justify the ungodly? How did he do it? Well, I got seven things here. Seven things of the adoption process of God Almighty. Number one, go to Psalm chapter 14. Psalm chapter 14, in verse number 2, it says, the Lord looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there were any that did understand and seek God. They've all gone aside. They've altogether become filthy. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. God is eternal, and he can look from the beginning of time to the end of time. And you know what he saw? None righteous. None seeking after God. The whole of humanity has fallen. No hope. None whatsoever. So what happened? He had to send his only begotten son. See, Jesus Christ was manifest in the flesh. As it says in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 16, it says God was manifest in the flesh. Great is the mystery of godliness. I was witnessing to a Muslim the other day in his car. Him and his name was Mufasa. Pray for this young man and his grandpa. But what he was saying to me, I kept on saying, Jesus is God. And he said, when was Jesus born? And I know what he was getting at. He was trying to say that Jesus was created. And I said, no, sir, he was manifested. That's what the Bible says. He's eternal. He is the creator. He is the all-powerful God. He was manifest. He was not created. He come into the flesh.
Amen.
1 John chapter 3 and verse number 5. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. So point number one of the adoption process, God looked down, he saw no hope. Number two, he said that Jesus Christ is their only hope, so he was manifest in the flesh. He came born of a virgin. Third thing I put down here, that he was tempted. Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. In verse number 15. It says this, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. Jesus Christ is 100% man, 100% God. Do I understand this? No, but this is what happened. He is 100% man, and he's 100% God. And he came to fulfill all the law. Not part of the law, not part of the prophecies, but he came to fulfill all these things. And he was tempted. But he's not tempted like we are in the fact that we're tempted from within. Jesus Christ was tempted from without. You see, Adam, he was born sinless. He was created sinless. But he was peccable. That means he could sin, and he did sin. That's why we're in such a mess we're in today. But Jesus Christ, he's impeccable, meaning he could not have sinned. He is God, but he felt all the same things that we have felt. He's our high priest. He understands what it means to be human. He hungered. He was tired. He was thirsty. He had sorrow. His closest friends, Peter, denied him. Judas betrayed him. He knows what it's like. He had sorrow upon sorrow. The description of Jesus Christ is that he is a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. Number four, the adoption process is that he fulfilled the law. As we said that in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17, we looked at that. He came not to destroy the law of God. He came not to destroy, but to fulfill it. Number five, he became our sin. It's amazing. The sinless Son of God became something he hated to save a people who hated him, who loved their sin. That is love. That is amazing. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 21, it says, he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He became our sin that we may have his righteousness. He drunk the full wrath of God in this adoption process, that we can be sons of God. The whole wrath, every drop, he took our hell for us. What an amazing love this is. He willingly went to the cross. Nobody made him. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 2. He went for the joy of setting his children free from sin. He went for the joy of adopting these children of disobedience, that they can become children of righteousness. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, with his stripes, we are healed. Isaiah 53. He died for the ungodly.
Amen.
You ever think about this? It's amazing to me. Jesus Christ, the one that has all power in heaven and in earth, he allowed these Roman soldiers to nail these nails through his hands and through his feet, smacking him in the face, railing on him, pulling his beard out, wearing that crown of thorns where his own precious blood ran down his face. And listen, he did that for the ungodly.
Amen.
Those Roman soldiers that did this to him, I wonder if one of them was adopted into the family of God after nailing the nail through his hands. That's the love of God, the one that nailed him to that tree. We nailed him to that tree. Our sin put Jesus Christ on that tree. Cursed is everyone that hangeth upon a tree. He did it willingly. He did it lovingly to save a bunch of wretched sinners like me and you. Number six, he was buried and rose again. Praise God. Turn to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. Starting in verse number 3, this is the gospel. The Bible gives a clear definition of what the gospel is. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I have also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Now what happened when He resurrected from the dead on the third day? What happened? It says there in 1 Corinthians, listen to what He accomplished by the cross, what He accomplished by His death, what He accomplished by His resurrection. It says in number 55, it says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. He came up out of the grave in victory. In victory over death, in victory over sin, in victory over the devil. Jesus Christ did all that for His children. Amen. It's amazing. Turn to Romans chapter 4 and number 25. Romans chapter 4 and number 25, it says this. Who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. Now, are we forgiven? Yes, by the blood of the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world. Yes, we're forgiven, but we're more than forgiven. I love this doctrine, the doctrine of justification. I love it. Just imagine, I use this analogy all the time. I say, if you get a ticket of some sort, and you go stand before the judge, and the judge looks at you, and he's feeling really good that day. He says, I'm just going to forgive you. You're off the hook. Yes! And you go out in the streets, you dance and celebrate. But that judge dies. He goes on to wherever he's going. And the next judge comes in. And he starts looking through the files. And he finds your ticket. And it just says, forgiven? This dude isn't paid for. It has to be paid for. That's the only way. And as he calls your house and he gets you to come back to the courthouse to stand before him, I sneak in and I pay that thing right before you get there. And now that thing is justified. It is paid for. Never to be brought up again. That your sin is as far as the east is from the west. It's gone in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is much more than just forgiveness. It is justified, paid for, gone. See you later. Bye-bye, sin. See you. All because of Jesus Christ. Number 7 of the adoption process. Jesus Christ ascended up to heaven. And He's going to come again for His saints, for His children. Isn't this amazing? This is God's adoption process to save a bunch of hell-bound sinners that have no hope outside of Christ. This is what Jesus did, that we may be adopted into the family of God. Adopted! That should make you excited. I know you don't look excited right now, but your hearts are excited. I know that. Man, I get excited about being adopted a son of God. Why did God go through so much trouble for us? Why did He do that for His name's sake? He did it to glorify His name. But my favorite is because He loved us. This is why He did it. Because His love is unmeasurable. It's so large and so wonderful and so pure. I can't describe the love of God. I just can't do it. And you know why He did this? I love this because He wanted to. God does what He wants to. That's why we call Him God. I'm so tired of people. I want a better answer than that. No. God wanted to. Amen. That's the only reason why I could be loved. You understand that? That's it. It's because He wanted to. That's amazing to me. I wouldn't love me, but God chose to love me. He chose to do that. Man, alive, what a wonderful thing. 1 John chapter 3, listen to this. Post this on your refrigerator for about 9 years. You ready? 1 John chapter 3, in verse number 1. Listen to this. I love this. Behold! Look at this thing. Behold! Behold what manner of love have the Father bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew Him not. Behold! What manner of love this is. How amazing is this love? How wonderful is this love? How much more should you want to serve Him and obey Him and live in holiness and worship Him all your days of your life because of His love? This adoption process that we as saints of God can now cry out to our Heavenly Father. Don't you love this? You can cry out to Him, as it says in our text, Abba, Daddy, Father. He hears you. He knows you. He knows your struggles. He has a plan. He's your father. My son could go down in the basement and he could find some rat poison or mouse poison that we have down there. And it looks pretty tasty. It may smell good to him. And he really wants it really bad. I mean, really bad. He just meant, this is a cookie I found. He'll come up to me like, Dad, can I eat this? He's never done this, by the way. But man, he can come up, Dad, can I eat this, please? Oh, I want this so bad. And I say, no. And I break his little heart. He doesn't understand it. He doesn't get it. But I know what's best. I'm his father. I'm for him. I'm not against him. That's the way your Heavenly Father is. You may be going through trials and tribulations and sicknesses and all these things going on in your life, but He's your Father. Amen. The word Abba is Father forwards and backwards. Abba, A-B-B-A. Backwards, A-B-B-A. He's your Father in good times and in bad times. He knows what He's doing. Amen. Just trust Him. Trust Him. Just hold on and just let God do it. He knows exactly what He's doing. And let me tell you something about God. He is not an absentee father. He cares about you. And sometimes you got to get a spanking every now and again. Hebrews chapter 12, verses number 5 through 11. And ye have not forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son. My daughter, listen, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of Him. For whom the Lord loveth, He chasteneth, and He scourgeth every son whom He receiveth. My son and daughter get spankings, and a lot of times we tell them, why do we spank you? Colin, why do we spank you? That's right, because we love you. That's exactly why we spank you. Number 7, if you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, you see that? If you're a child of God, you will get chastened of the Lord. You will receive scourgings. You will receive spankings. Listen, but if you do not receive spankings, if you're without chastisement, then you are bastards. You have not a Heavenly Father. If you're living in sin and you're just having a good old great time in your sin and you say, oh yes, I'm a Christian, you're probably a bastard. The Holy Spirit will convict you of your sin. You will not enjoy your sin. Furthermore, in verse number 9, we had fathers of our flesh with corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For verily, for a few days chasten us after their own pleasure, but He for our profit, that we might be partakers of His holiness. That's why He does it. He wants you to be holy as He is holy. He's conforming you to the image of His Son. Point number 2, secured by adoption. Here in America, soon as the parents of the little child go through all the hurdles, I mean, there's a lot of hurdles. Soon as they go through all these things and they're stamped, approved by the government, by the judge, all these things, soon as that happens, that child is now part of that family. Legally, they are the same as the biological children. Exactly the same. There's no difference. They have the same last name. There's no returns. There's no takebacks. It doesn't matter what this adopted child becomes. If they become really ugly, really bad, really stupid, whatever the case is, that is your child. The same as the one that was born from the mom. He is part of your family. Once a child of disobedience, a child of wrath, is born again into the Spirit, into the kingdom of God, covered by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are forever a child of God, putting on the Lord Jesus Christ. Becoming a new creature in Christ Jesus, being stamped by the blood of Jesus Christ, approved by the Father through the Son. You are eternally, eternally a child of God. Amen. Eternally. That is exciting. Once you are adopted by God, you're forever a child of God. You'll never be the same. Listen, being a Christian, man, is like being hit by a semi-truck. You ever heard that? You'll never be the same. Never. Never be the same. Now, what if I was late to church some Sunday, which that day will probably come, and I come in, and I say, man, I'm so sorry I'm late. I was hit by a semi-truck out there. And you look at me and say, man, you are a liar. You're walking around. Because if I got hit by a semi-truck, I would be dead, or I'd be in the hospital. I would be a liar. There are some heresies being taught by false teachers with this doctrine, eternal security. You know what they do? This is wicked, man. I don't know if you've ever experienced this in your life. I don't know. But at services, they have the invitation. And I'm not saying there's anything 100% wrong with invitation, but they come forward and they tell them, it says, oh, you want to be saved, don't you? Well, yeah. Okay, well, you want to be saved? Well, here's what you just got to do. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Just call on him. Well, how do I do that? Just bow your head. Repeat after me. Oh, God, come into my heart. Save my soul, blah, blah, blah. And then that person goes out, and they live like the devil. But if that guy ever comes back to that pastor, he says, don't you remember you said that prayer with me? You're eternally secure. Go on. You're fine. That's a doctrine of the devil. Man, if I wanted to, listen, I could get all of North Dayton saved. Go door to door and say, you don't want to go to hell, do you? Unless they're really wicked. They'll say, no. I don't want to go to hell. Well, here, come here. Come here, just bow your head. Repeat after me. You're eternally secure. I'll never see you at church. I'll never see you repenting of your sin. I'll never see you reading the Bible. There's no change in your life. And see, we need to be under the impression, if we come across these people, and I came across them all day yesterday, coming to the door with pot fumes coming out of their house, beer on their breath, a cuss word out of their mouth, and they sit there and say, I'm saved. We need to call them out. Say, sir, by the fruit, I believe you're lost. You are not saved. If you die tonight, you're on your way to hell. I believe that. Now, I can't for sure say that, but all I can tell you is I believe it by your fruit. You're not eternally secured. We got to be bold with this because people are going to hell because of false doctrines and false teachers, this Arminian free will of man nonsense. That's what's going on in this world. They have no Holy Ghost conviction. Once saved, always saved. I say no fruit, no repentance. You never were saved. There's a drastic change in your life. You love the things that you used to hate and you hate the things you used to love. There's a drastic change. You're born again, a child of God. A huge difference in your life. And once you're born again and saved, you're forever a child of God. Forever. Let's read some scriptures about this wonderful doctrine in John chapter 10. Let's read a few of these. John chapter 10 in verse number 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. And they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. You see that? No man can pluck them out of his hand, not even yourself. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. John 4 and verse number 14. John number 4 and verse number 14. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst ever again. You are fulfilled in Christ. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Anybody believes the false doctrine that you can be saved and lose your salvation? Be saved, lose your salvation. If you just take them to the word everlasting. What does everlasting mean? What does the word eternal mean? I mean, it's so right in front of your face. How could you not understand this thing? It's eternal. Once you're born again, it's forever. Let's go to Romans chapter 8. I love this scripture. I love every scripture, but I just like saying it every time.
Amen.
Romans chapter 8, and starting in verse number 35. Listen to this. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulations or distress or persecutions or famines or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. More than conquerors. For I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You cannot be separated from the love of God once you are a child of God. You cannot, it will not happen. Nothing can separate you. You are sealed unto the day of redemption. Sealed. Back to our springboard text in Romans chapter 8. We're right there in verses number 15, 16, and 17. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Perfect love casteth out fear. But he that receiveth the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You hear that? You can know that you're a child of God. How? The Spirit of God bears witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. You are. The 1 John, turn there. Just read a couple scriptures. If you're here today and God has really changed your life, you have forgiveness and you have repented of your sins and put all your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you're born again, but you're doubting your salvation. I can't confirm that. I can't say that you're saved. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But the thing is, His Spirit will bear witness. You will know that you're a child of God. He doesn't want you to walk around thinking, am I saved? Am I lost? Am I saved? Am I lost? He wants you to know. John chapter 2 and verse number 3, that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. You know that you're a child of God because you love his commandments. His commandments are not grievous unto him. You want to read the Bible. You want to pray. You have an earnest desire to be next to the Lord Jesus Christ, to be next to God. John chapter 3 and verse number 14 says this, We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. 1 John 5 in verse 13. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life. That ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. You see that? You should know that you're a child of God. Just as much as you know who your mom and dad are, or know that you're alive right here in this room, you may know that you're a child of God. In the Webster's Dictionary, listen, if you ever look words up, I would really highly recommend a Webster's 1828 dictionary. It's good. Don't go with the new one. Go with the old one. It has even Bible verses in it. Listen to what Webster says, the word adoption. Are you ready? To take a stranger into one's family as a son or heir. To take one who is not a child and treat him as one, giving him a title and the privileges and the rights of a child. Now, spiritually, the word adoption is this: to receive the sinful child of men into the family of God or the kingdom of God in God's favor and protection, by which they become heirs of salvation by Christ. It's
It's wonderful. Let's administer unto your hearts. The worst day here is nothing if you're saved, if you're blood washed, if you're a child of God. Listen to this. Feel free to amen. Feel free. Listen. A Christian has a life that can never be forfeited. A relationship that can never be abrogated. A righteousness that can never be tarnished. An acceptance that can never be questioned. A judgment that can never be repeated. A title that can never be clouded. A standing that can never be disputed. A justification that can never be reversed. A seal that can never be broken. I don't hear any amens. Amen. This is exciting. Are you a child of God? An inheritance that can never be taken away. A peace that can never be disturbed. A joy that can never be suppressed. A power that can never be extinguished. Listen to this. A salvation that can never be annulled. A glory that can never be dimmed. A destiny that can never be changed. Did you hear that? Are you born again? Are you a child of God? You are eternally adopted, accepted into the beloved, not by what you have done, but by what Jesus Christ has done. You are an heir of salvation, an heir of all that God has. Point number three, adopted to be heir. No matter if you're saved or lost, you are an heir to something. You are an heir with something. With Christ, being a saint forever. Without Christ, you are a child of wrath. Eternally destined for hell. With Christ, you're an heir of righteousness. Without Christ, you're an heir of sin. You're an heir of what was created for the devil and his angels. Hell. With Christ, you're an heir of salvation. Without Christ, you're an heir of eternal condemnation. With Christ, you're an heir to be sinless. Amen. Praise God. Without Christ, you're going to be in your sin forever. Who is an heir of hell? I'll just give you these scripture references. All who reject Christ and die in their sin. All the unrighteous. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 through 11. All the unbelieving. Revelation 21 verse number 8. All those who work iniquity. Matthew chapter 7 verse number 23. Who is the heir of heaven? Whosoever shall call. Romans 10. 13. Whosoever shall call, Acts 2 and verse number 21. Whosoever shall confess, Matthew 10 and verse number 32. John chapter 4 and number 15. Whosoever does the will of God, Matthew 12 and verse number 50. 1 John 2:17. Whosoever shall lose his life, Matthew 16 and verse number 25. Whosoever receiveth Christ, Mark chapter 9 and verse number 37. Whosoever believeth, John chapter 3 and verse 15 and 16. And John chapter 11 verse number 26. The Bible's important, man. We gotta back everything up we say with the word of God. Whosoever will, Revelation 22 and verse number 17. Praise God for the whosoever's. This is why the doctrines of grace is so magnificent, that we go forth and we don't know who's going to be saved, but there's a lot of whosoever's out there. A lot of whosoever's. The most wicked, drunkard, the most vile person has hope because of Christ. If it's up to that man, there is no hope. But it's not up to him. It's up to God to quicken him, to make him a child of God, to be predestinated, to be conformed to the image of his Son, as it says in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 5. To be adopted, to be secured. Listen to this in our scripture. Turn back to Romans chapter 8. I just want to tell you this. This is just wonderful. If you think about it and just ponder on it. We are heirs with Christ. That's what it says. Number 17. The children, then heirs. Heirs of God. Listen to this. Joint heirs with Christ. Joint heirs. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Glorified with Christ. Do you hear that? Joint heirs. Because it says in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 2, everything is God's. All of this is his.
And in Revelation chapter 21 and verse number 7, it says that we shall, by the grace of God, inherit everything that is His. We are the children of God, joint heirs with Christ. Everything that is His is ours because of His love, because of His grace, because of this adoption process. And listen to this, Revelation. This is a crazy verse. I want you to maybe look over this sometime. But in Revelation chapter 3, in verse number 21, not only, listen, does He give you the new heaven, the new earth, He gives you everything because it's His, and you are now His, and everything that is yours. You're a joint heir with Christ. But in Revelation chapter 3, in verse number 21, it says this, listen, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne. What? Even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in His throne. He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Did you hear that? We can sit with God in His throne? That's how loving. You think God is so far away, and you're unable to enter Him, but man, Jesus Christ has broken down the walls of partition. He's broken down all these things that we can be close to God. You can lay down flat on your face in your room and be with Him, your Father in heaven who cares for you. I love this. I just love it. I was out at work last night. I went out in my truck, put something away, and man, I was just beholding the stars and the moon that God has created. And man, I have a dad in heaven that loves me, cares for me more than anybody could. I'm a joint heir with Him. Man, I love that. These dear people out here, it's just so sad. They don't have no Heavenly Father. They just live day to day. Man, before God saved me, I was eating out of the trash can of life, you know? And I thought that's all there was. That's all I was doing, day to day. But God changed me and saved me and adopted me by His grace and love and mercy. And now I have an eternal home in heaven. I mean, that is something to dance about. That is something to rejoice about. We are joint heirs forever in heaven. Forever, a place of peace, a place of beauty, no sadness, no tears, no sin, eternally with God. No sun, S-U-N, but the sun giveth light. Amen. The S-O-N, the sinless Son of God. What makes heaven so wonderful is we get to see Jesus. We get to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Because no matter how much I try to worship Him here and love Him here, I'm still flawed. But in heaven, I get to worship God with all my heart, all my mind, all my soul, everything I have. I get to worship Him and I get to be like Him. He is my inheritance. Jesus Christ is our inheritance. We get to be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is, because we should be like Him, sinless. I don't have to worry about this old flesh I drag around all the time and I have to deal with and repent daily in my wicked mind. I don't have to worry about that anymore. Man, that's exciting to me. Maybe you're not excited because you need to be born again. You ever think about that? This isn't moving your heart. Nothing will. Nothing will. You need to be moved by the Spirit of God. We get to be like Him. We get to spend eternity with Him, sinless, forever. Man, what a wonderful thing it is. I remember my mom, when I was lost, she's a faithful Christian, and I said to her, Mom, all you Christians do is care about dying and going to heaven. You don't enjoy nothing here on this earth. Man, I was stupid. Man, but the truth is, man, we get to enjoy our inheritance now. Now, we get to spend our time with God. He hears you. He loves you. He cares for you. He'll never leave you. He sends His great comforter to comfort you. The world does not have that. You know what they turn to comfort? A bottle of booze. They turn to drugs. They turn to alcohol. They turn to everything else under the sun. And it all is vanity. But we have the Holy Spirit. We have the fruits of the Spirit. Eternal love and joy and peace. Man, and long suffering and gentleness and meekness and temperance, we can enjoy
our inheritance now. The problem is many Christians do not enjoy their inheritance now. You know what they do? They just try to serve the God of this world and worry about all this stuff. God will take that. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Serve God first. All these things will be taken care of. And see, to be adopted should humble you so much. Should not make you high-minded, walk around puffed up like you're something special. Well, you are special to God, but man alive, it's nothing that you have done. Amen. Being adopted and knowing this truth should make you want to serve God all the more. I'm a child of the King. I am a priest of the High Priest. I am a king of the High King. No man can do nothing to me, man. Nothing. I love that. God loves us. When you want to be obedient because of this doctrine, to serve him, to be crucified to ourselves, and just to love him and serve him all the days of our lives. In conclusion is this: knowing what God's done for me, knowing that I'm eternally secured by his blood, knowing that I'm a joint heir with Christ. I mean, I only named 7 things that it makes me want to do, but there's a lot more. I'm sure I could name a lot more. But number one, it makes me want to just lie flat on my face and worship him forever. Just worship him forever. Everything he's given, man. Everything he's done. God Almighty. I just want to die completely to myself and my flesh and live unto him, to sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs. You ever do that? Just by yourself, nobody's around? Especially if you got a bad voice like me. Man alive, but you still sing with your heart. Amen. And you just make a joyful noise. It may not sound joyful to somebody else, but unto God's ears, your dad's ears, he loves it. Amen. He enjoys it. Sing unto the God Almighty who did so much for you to save you. It makes me want to preach from the rooftops, to love my brothers and sisters all the more, to love the lost world that has no hope all the more. It makes me want to dance and sing and jump and do a backflip. I'm too old to do that. I hurt my back. I can't do a backflip. I might try sometime. In heaven, man, I'll be doing a backflip. Come see me. That's what I'll do. Man, it makes me want to preach the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world to find all my brothers and sisters in Christ. Because they're out there. Right here in Old North Dayton. That young man that walked out of here, he may be a child of God. He's thinking, that's boring. He's talking about the Bible. He has no relationship with God. But man, one of these days, maybe today even, God may quicken him and adopt him by the precious blood of his son.